Okay, welcome everyone. It is my great pleasure to introduce Jacques Cremer from the Toulouse School of Economics. And on one hand, on some level, Jacques does not require an introduction because I think most people in this community are aware and are in awe of his striking results. You know, the Cremer-MacLean mechanism of full extraction, full surplus extraction, probably one of the most beautiful results in auction theory. And so I think most of you know this. And just as a side remark, you know, I downloaded the paper last night, the 88 paper, and it's only 11 pages. So if people are complaining about the 18 page limit at EC, you know, I will not be accepting those complaints going forward. But on the other hand, what the community may be less aware of is that, you know, auction theory is just one dimension of Jacques' research. He has also worked in a whole bunch of other areas. He's worked on contract theory and incentives. He has worked on organizational economics and theory of the firm. He's worked on planning theory. So his research really spans lots of different areas of economic theory. And perhaps even more remarkably and unusually for a, you know, for a pure economic theorist, Jacques has also done some very important applied and practical work, and in particular, for about a year, from April 2018 until March 2019, he was a special advisor to the European Commissioners for Competition. In that capacity, he has co-authored the report on competition policy for the digital era. So a lot of important issues on the digital economy, platform competition, antitrust, and, you know, a lot of other things that were in the news up until the pandemic struck. And, you know, I'm sure when the pandemic is over, all of those things will be, again, top of everyone's mind. And today, Jacques is going to talk about, you know, a topic that's related to that, you know, dynamic competition between platforms, obviously super important. So I'm looking forward to seeing that. And Jacques, it's all you.
Thank you very much, Mike. And thank you very much for inviting me. Yeah, just about the length of papers, I relooked at the issue of Econometrica, where my dissertation paper was published, which was on the planning theory. None of the papers were 12 pages long, and all the introductions were one page long or less. So life was better once upon a time. So we're not in Budapest, but behind me, you see one of the auditoriums in the new TSC building, which is absolutely fantastic. So I hope that everybody plans to come and visit us sometime soon once this crisis is finished. What I'd like to do is try to speak to you a little bit about dynamic, the work I've been doing for the last 10 years, it should have been less, but I'm very slow. The last 10 years on dynamic competitions, dynamic competition between platforms, I think there is lots of work which can be usefully done at the intersection of CS, computer science, and economics, and I'd like to draw your attention to this. So most of this work was done with Gary Biglaser at the University of Carolina. But I've participated also Gergely Dobos and André Veiga, who were PhD students at Toulouse, and Gergely is the European Commission, and André is at the college. So there are four main things I would like to speak about in the 40 minutes or so. First, I'm going to speak about dynamic competition, winner-take-all. So I'd like, in the winner-take-all markets, I'm really thinking about the markets in which you have one big firm who has a tendency of being the winner, not markets in which you can have several platforms. I'll speak a little bit more about this in the conclusion. I'd like, one of the themes is going to be to try to contrast the effect of switching costs and network effects. And you see that even though they are very similar and lots of people have stressed their similarities, I will try to show that actually their effects can be quite different. I'd like to speak about how the heterogeneity of consumers has got very strange consequences in the dynamic models and give very surprising results. And finally, at the end of the talk, I will spend about 10 minutes thinking about what do we know about the basis of incumbency advantage when there are network effects. Okay, so I will then forget about switching costs and go and look at the games that consumers play when there are network effects. Even though I'm from Toulouse and everybody in Toulouse always speak about two-sidedness, I will not speak about two-sidedness. So there's no two-sidedness except in the conclusion. So as Mike very kindly said, I participated in the writing of this report for Commissioner Vestager last year. And with two co-authors, Heike Schweitzer, who's a law professor in Berlin, and Yves-Alexandre Monjoie, who I guess a number of you must know, who's works on the privacy and in the computing department at the Imperial College. And I won't go through the whole report, but there's one sentence which we wrote, which I'd like to point out to. So we begin the report by giving an overview of what we think are the main important characteristics of the digital market. And we say experience shows that large incumbent digital players are very difficult to dislodge. And one thing which is interesting is that we have very, very little evidence about how bad this is. I mean, we think it's true, but we have very little evidence of what are the costs of this. Because it's very hard to dislodge incumbents, they probably have very, very strong incentives to keep their dominant position, and hence presumably strong incentive to prevent the entrants from dislodging them and probably to engage in anti-competitive behavior. But again, this is what we believe. We don't really have strong evidence on this. And because of all those factors, we say that we really need vigorous competition policy enforcement, and everybody who follows the news on this Phil knows that lots of people have called for vigorous competition policy enforcement. Right now, the EU is beginning a discussion about how do you define firms with a bottleneck, who hold a bottleneck, and what should you do about them. And one of the problems is actually we know very, very little about competition in digital markets. We think they have those properties, but the theory is not very developed, and it's very, very difficult to do empirics because we don't have lots of apples to do empirics with. Okay, so what I'm going to do here is to present you some of the theory which I think we can use in order to look at those factors. So I'm going to begin by a very, very simple model. So I'm going to go through a number of things, but really trying to go for the very simple models. At times, you're going to think, oh, but there are complications. Yes, there are complications. I'm trying to avoid speaking about them. I'll be very happy to discuss them in the Q&A question. So let's first begin by forgetting about the dynamics, okay? So very simple static model, one period model, in which we're going to have one incumbent, okay, who's, for some reason or the other, every consumer participated, belonged to, purchased from that incumbent in the previous period. And many entrants, we're going to, in everything I'm going to do, except totally at the end, I'm going to assume that there is free entry, many entrants. For simplicity, we assume zero cost. There's going to be no price discrimination, but that's not going to be very important. And there's going to be a very simple Stackelberg timing, where the incumbent is going to choose the price it charges, the entrants are going to choose their prices, and the consumers are going to choose the platform. In everything I'm doing, I'm going to assume that the consumers are indifferent to the service provided by all the platforms. The platforms are all identical. The question is, how do you access a platform at minimum cost? And when there are network effects, where do you find other people. The utility is entirely going to come from the presence of other consumers, not from the from differentiation between the platforms. Although again, that's an important issue to work on. So assume they're switching costs and assume that every consumer is, all the consumers are identical for the time being. And the switching cost for all those consumers is equal to sigma. Okay. So the entrant, the incumbent knows that the entrants are going to be willing to price only down to zero, their cost is equal to zero, and hence it can price up to sigma, the level of a switching cost, and no consumer is going to have incentives to migrate. Hence, the price is going to be equal to sigma, and if there is a mass of alpha of consumers, the profit of incumbent is going to be alpha sigma. And of course, this is efficient because there is no, we're not incurring any switching costs. With network effects, the situation is somewhat similar. So I'm going to call nu the amount that the consumer is willing to pay in order to be connected to a mass one of other consumers. So alpha nu is the value to the consumers, to each consumer, of being connected and being on the same platform than everybody else. Okay, and same reasoning holds. The price that the entrants are willing to go down to is zero, in order to keep the consumers, so that the consumers don't have an incentive to move, the incumbent is going to charge alpha nu, and its profit is going to be alpha squared times nu. And again, this is efficient because all the consumers are all on the same platform, which is how efficiency is determined in that market. Now, let me speak for a little bit for a second about the efficiency issues, because there is an interesting twist here which would show that even though things look very similar between network effect and switching costs, actually things are a little bit different. Assume that the entrants offer epsilon more utility than the incumbent. They're the next generation, so hence they're a little bit better. With switching costs, the consumers are going to pay sigma minus epsilon, because the cost of migrating for a consumer is sigma, the benefit is epsilon, the incumbent is going to be able to price sigma minus epsilon. If epsilon, the consumers are not going to migrate, and efficiency is going to be preserved, okay, if epsilon is smaller than sigma. With network effects, on the other hand, I mean, A, the same thing is going to happen from a positive viewpoint, because the incumbent platform is going to be able to charge alpha nu minus epsilon, but the consumers are going to stay on the incumbent. But in this case, this is inefficient. Okay, this is inefficient because we would be better off if all the consumers went on the one of the entrant platform. There's no switching cost. They're better. They will all get the same network benefits plus the benefit from the other incumbent. So now this is an illustration that something that Hal Varian said a long time ago, and you can find in the Berkeley lectures on his website. Network efforts lead to substantial collective switching costs and lock-in. Okay, network effects are a little bit like switching costs, but they're even worse when individual switching costs, this is an example which I've shown you, due to the cost of coordination. So now let's put this in a very, very simple dynamic framework. So right now it's going to be just two periods. So in the first period, we have an incumbent, we have consumers, exactly the same thing happens as what happened in what I was showing you. And in the second period, whoever acquired consumer, whichever platform acquired consumer in the first period, becomes the incumbent, and we play the same stack up game. It's very easy to show It's very easy to there's a mistake in my slide, so don't I will correct it in a second. It's very easy to show that the incumbent is going to want to keep on being the incumbent. And for just for that formula, I've assumed that the mass of consumers is one. In the second period, the incumbent, who's still going to be incumbent, is going to be able to charge sigma. Hence, its profit per unit of consumers is going to be sigma, and that's discounted to today, it's going to be worth delta sigma. Now, in the current period, so this is representing what's happening in the first period, the entrants are willing to charge minus delta sigma, because that's the value of the consumers out of which they're going to get a price equal to sigma in the next period. Hence, the entrant is going to be able to charge sigma minus delta sigma. Okay, he can charge what the entrants are willing to charge plus the switching cost. And we see that the total profit is equal to sigma. So the total discounted profit over two periods is equal to sigma. And I won't go through the reasoning, but the reasoning is exactly similar in the case of network effects. Okay, so what we get that you don't really get rich on switching costs alone. Switching costs or network effects, you don't hit them every period because the future profits from switching costs are going to be eaten away by the competition. That's another type of phenomena that Paul Klemperer, about 40 years ago, showed in his dissertation at Stanford. Okay, but I don't think it had been noticed in the literature that the profits are exactly similar in this case to the one-period profit. Now, where it gets more interesting is when we introduce different types of consumers, and I'm going to do that in a very simple model, assuming that there are, in the case of switching costs, some consumers which have got a strictly positive switching cost, and other consumers who have zero switching cost. But before I go on, Mike, are there any questions?
I'm not seeing any questions, by the way, to all the attendees. If you want to ask a question, you know, feel free to ask on Q&A, and then I will bring it up with Jack. But for now, I'm not seeing any questions.
Okay. Thank you. And don't hesitate to ask questions, please. I would much rather answer questions than speak to people who are not getting what I'm saying. So so with those heterogeneity, you don't get many points on the exam for guessing that the price is still going to be equal to sigma, okay, because the consumers with a zero switching cost have got absolutely no value. You can't get any profit out of them. And the profit of the incumbent is going to be alpha H times sigma, where alpha H is, of course, the mass of consumers who've got a high switching cost. Okay, the H stands for high. With network effects, what I'm going to assume here is that the consumers with the low network effect consumers for the time being don't care about the network effect. They just care about joining a platform, but they are not sensitive at all to networks. And on top of that, they don't bring any benefits to the H consumers, to the consumers with high network effect. And then in this case, the reasoning is exactly the same. The price is alpha H times mu, which is the value of network effects of high network effect consumers. And the profit of the incumbent is going to be alpha squared H times mu. And now the situation becomes interesting because let's try to figure out what happens with dynamics. Now I'm going to switch to an infinite horizon model, which allows us to avoid mixed strategies. And I'm going to look at stationary equilibria. Okay, so pi is a profit of incumbent. And again, it's easy, but you still have to do it to show that it wants to stay the incumbent. So is profit starting at the beginning of time one? Is its profit starting at the beginning of time two, discounted by delta? It's the same pi because of the stationarity. And in the problem is, what are the entrants going to be willing to charge? Well, the entrants know that they're going to become to make a profit delta pi in case they get to be the incumbent next period. But this delta pi, this minus delta pi, this subsidy they're going to have to give to the consumers, they're going to have to give to all the consumers, both the H consumers and the L consumers. Remember we said no discrimination. And therefore, the price they're going to be willing to offer is minus delta pi over alpha H plus alpha L. And the incumbent is going to be able to charge that price, that price plus sigma, and its profits are going to be alpha H times the price it can charge. And this is going to repeat period after period. And you can do the algebra is very simple to do, and we get pi, which is equal to this expression here, on which I will comment in a second. And we can do the same exercise with network effects. I won't do it, but the reasoning is exactly the same. So notice the first thing here, which is kind of strange, is that the profit of the incumbent is greater than the one period profit. This quantity here is less than one, and hence this thing is going to be less than one. And hence the profit is alpha H sigma multiplied by all of this thing. Okay. You can also show that the profit is still smaller than what would be the one period profit, alpha H sigma over one minus delta. Okay, obviously because you're adding this term. So the profit is bounded above by the one, below by the one period profit, and above by the repetition every period of the one period profit. What's happening is that when you add zero switching cost customers or zero network effect customers, you increase the profit of the incumbent. And the reason for this is that the L consumers are accepting the offers that the entrants are making. So an entrant is saying, oh, I'm going to give a subsidy in order to attract consumers. Both the H and the L consumers accept the subsidy, but the L consumers have got no value because next period they're going to accept the subsidy for the next period entrant. Okay, and hence the low switching cost customers or the low network effects customers who never purchase from the incumbent actually increase its profit. Okay, so again, this is very simple example, but I want to show you that the effects are indeed quite complicated and somewhat surprising and interesting when we begin looking at the dynamics of those markets.
Jacques, before you proceed, there are two questions actually. There's a question from Chenhao Zhang. Can you clarify exactly what you mean by network effects here? I guess especially with heterogeneity. So his question is, the network effect refers to having some kind of graph topology of the network, or what exactly do you mean by network effects, especially with heterogeneity?
I'll make a few comments about this in the conclusion. Here I'm being a poor, very simple economist. There is no topology, anything. It's network effects in the meaning of a simplest-minded economic literature, which is that the utility that the consumers are getting from participating to a platform depends on the total number, the total mass of other consumers. So you see it here, the H consumers have a utility which is equal to alpha H, the mass of those consumers who are staying with incumbent, time mu, which is the value they attach to being linked to a mass of one of consumers. Okay, there are lots of interesting things to be done to look at more complicated network structures and how this would play along But I don't know that anybody has tried to do that in that type of setup.
Okay. And another related question from Nicole, do the H consumers benefit from the L consumers?
No,
and if they didn't, how would things change?
Things will change. I will discuss this in a second. For that example, the H consumers don't benefit from the L consumers, and the L consumers don't benefit from the H consumers, and don't benefit from the other L consumers.
Okay.
But what I want to do now is show you what are the difficulties which arise if we begin thinking about more complicated model where the L consumers actually benefit from each other and from the H consumers. I won't present you the results because I just don't have time, but you will see what the really interesting modeling issues.
Okay.
And that's what's happening here, more complicated heterogeneity with network effects.
Perfect.
So the model here is an infinite horizon model, still a discount factor smaller than one. And there's going to be two types of consumers, H and L. And the consumers derive a utility notice it doesn't depend on the platform, just depend on the type of a consumer. And on the, so if a consumer is on platform I, U doesn't depend on I, but depends on the mass of consumers of the same type and of mass of the consumers of the other type which are on the platform. Okay. There are a number of conditions on the utilities which are not very stringent, except to make sure that H and L are well defined and that there's enough difference between how much those consumers enjoy network effects. All consumers are initially incumbent and the same type of model which we have here. Okay. So there, if you make the dynamic model, and I need to spell it out a little bit more to show you the complications, the period one starts with one incumbent. And in the period after this, after one, you could have one or more incumbents. Okay. The incumbent set the prices. So there could be several of them, the simultaneous game, the entrants set the prices. And then the consumers have to play a game to choose which of the networks they're going to join. And I'm going to focus on this game in a second. Okay. And of course, we keep on going around in circles forever and ever. Okay. Now, notice one thing is that in particular, we're interested in this thing in when there are going to be inefficiently two networks, okay? Which means that we're going to have two different incumbents to take care of, and we're going to have to decide how do the consumers react when they are in different incumbents and they've got different platforms who are offering prices. How do we predict what is going to be the configuration of the consumers after they finish deciding on which platform to move, okay? And so what we do in a paper with Gary Biglaser is the following. We say, assume that we are in an allocation of consumers between platform, okay? Would some consumers gain from moving? If it's no, okay, we go on the green arrow and we are finished. Life is great, okay? The problem is what happened if some consumers gain from moving? Because how do we go about deciding where they're going to move, how they're going to move? Okay. So what we try to do is the way we model this is we say, well, let's take the consumers who would gain the most from moving. So you compute for every consumer what is the greatest gain he can gain from moving. Takes the greatest of all those gains, again, across all consumers, you assume that some of the consumers with the highest guess from moving move. Imagine a small group of consumers who really would gain from moving move, okay? And then you have another allocation and you say in this new allocation, would some consumers gain from moving? No, we are finished. Yes, we keep on going. And so the way in which we build this process, eventually you come to the point at which it is no. And then this is the way in which we solve this thing, the consumers play the within period thing. This is a very, very kind of No, strange, no, not strange. It's, I think it's very smart, but it's a very, very caricatural way of doing this. And we really need more work on this issue. How do we, how do consumers allocate themselves when there are network effects? Okay, using this, we have a necessary and sufficient condition for the existence of two networks in the stationary equilibrium, and this is inefficient. Okay, it's more difficult. We don't get necessary and sufficient condition, but pretty close for the existence of one network. Okay, it's a little bit difficult because when we have one network, we need to figure out, assume that the out of equilibrium moves could be that consumers join two networks. And what happens after they've joined two networks? Do they re-go back to the one network, or do they keep being split? So the theory gets quite complicated. And we get the same type of results, you know, in terms of profitability and so on, of incumbent, as we did in our very, very simple case earlier. Okay, there are lots to be said about this model, but I really want to go to the last issue I wanted to raise, okay, which again we need much more work, and I'm trying to recruit people who would like to work on this. Okay, and I think it's something on which there's quite a bit of both theoretical and applied work to do. But Mike, before doing this, I should ask you, are there any questions?
Yep, there is one additional question from Nicole. Isn't that the observations you make unique to order of who you move? Why start with the one that has the highest gain?
Because otherwise I didn't know how to solve a model. We have examples in which, so we thought that we could solve the models by assuming that just being agnostic about who would move. But if you're agnostic, actually, you can show that sometimes you'd converge to strange, unstable equilibria. So, and I don't know how to do that in a more principled way. Okay. So I cheated earlier, and what the one thing I was worried about presenting this presentation is somebody would call me on this, and that there would be a question here. So go back to our very, very simple network effect case with homogeneous consumers. All the consumers are the same, and no heterogeneity, static model, and so on. I told you that the price would be alpha times nu, which is the value of the network effects for the consumers, so each individual consumer. But of course, if we look at the game in which the consumers decide, do we stay on the incumbent, or do we move to an entrant? If they all move to the entrant, they get a utility of alpha nu. The entrants are charging zero, and they get the benefits of the network effects. Okay. If they stay with the incumbent, their net benefits is zero. They get a benefit from network effects equal to alpha nu, and they charge alpha nu. Okay, so there are two equilibria in the game that the consumers are playing. In this case, I don't need to do any dynamics. It's a very simple Nash game. In most of economic theory, when there are several equilibria, we assume that the players coordinate on the Pareto optimal equilibrium. In the theory of platforms, we always assume that they give a benefit to the incumbents. Okay? So some of the literature, and there's very interesting literature on this, does this through beliefs. They basically assume that the consumers believe that the equilibrium which is favorable to the incumbent will prevail. Okay. What we've been trying to do with Gary Biglaser and Andre Vega is to try to see whether or not we could think about something which would be a little bit more subtle than this. And, one of the reasons for this is that sometimes we don't believe that the benefit of incumbent advantage would be that big. So for instance, there was a Microsoft GitHub merger about 3 years ago, 2 years ago, where Microsoft bought GitHub And GitHub, as you know, all know, is a platform for collaboration. Hence, there are strong network effects. And the commission decided that in this case, even if Microsoft decreased the quality of a platform, for instance, by favoring its own product, the users were sophisticated enough or something enough that they would be able to migrate very easily to an alternative network, which means that it's not, no, what's happening here, okay? So what we've been trying to do is trying to think about this by modeling the migration process, okay? And basically saying, look, migration is not a simultaneous game. Actually, people move one after the other and they're trying to look at what the other ones are doing before deciding to migrate. Now, it turns out that just assuming sequential decisions is not enough to kill incumbency advantage. And there's a very nice paper from the 80s by Farrell and Salonen who do a model like this, which they apply to a standard adoption, but which we can apply to migration between platforms. Assume that you've got N people. So for a second, we've got a finite number of people. You've got an incumbent platform and an entrant platform, which is much better. Which is better, Pareto better. So if everybody moved from the incumbent platform to the entrant platform, everybody would be better off. And assume that the consumers, that the users are deciding one after the other whether or not to move. Okay. The last consumer, if everybody has moved, if n minus one consumers have moved, the last consumer is clearly going to move. If n minus two consumers have moved, the n minus second consumer thinks, oh, if I move, the last consumer is going to move, and I prefer the entrant platform to the incumbent platform, and the n minus second consumer moves, and you unravel all of this, and it's clear that sequentiality is not enough to kill incumbency advantage. On the other hand, what we are going to do is we're going to assume, we're going to assume that actually, the agents are trying to wait before migrating. So that if you refuse to move, if you're consumer one, you're going to get another chance. And yet you think, let me wait until all the other guys have gone to the new platform, have suffered a little bit with no network effects, and then I will move later. Can we can we get incumbency advantage? Okay. And so the model is going to be very simple. It's a continuous time model. At time zero, all consumers are on the incumbent platform. And then during a period of time t plus dt, the consumers can only migrate from the incumbent to the entrant, assuming that migration is irreversible. And during the time dt, a proportion mu of, which depends on the number of consumers on the entrant platform and the number of consumers of the incumbent platform, are asked, do you want to move? Okay, so you can think of it, either they get the information, or you can think of it as behaviorally, they think, oh, now it's time for me to decide whether or not to move. Okay, so this is a migration process. In every period of time dt, a proportion mu of the consumers who are on the incumbent platform can decide whether or not to move. We are asking ourselves, basically, it's a bit more complicated than this, by the question, when does there exist equilibrium of these games such that people migrate?
Jacques, so there is another question from Yash Kanoria. So if people can move sort of without delay, right? It sounds like everyone would move to the entrant platform in the sequential model, right? But just by backwards induction. Yeah. So why doesn't that kill incumbency advantage? That's the question.
Oh yeah, so if they all can move at the same time, okay, you could have, they would all decide to move. But here we are assuming that they move sequentially. Okay, so we're assuming, assume that there is a constraint, which is either a behavioral or a physical constraint, that they can't all migrate at the same time. Okay, is that sufficient to provide some incumbency advantage? And what would be the determinants of incumbency advantage in this case? Okay, but agree. So for what I'm saying here, the sequentiality is very important. Okay. So very quickly, the condition for equilibrium turned out to be, does the first guy who's asked whether he wants to move, is he willing to move? Okay, or is she willing to move? Okay, and the utility, if the first consumer migrates, okay, her utility, well, she's going to be in the, on the entrant, and the utility is going to depend on the number of other people on the entrant, and this is going to be infinite, the benefit she gets from moving. If she stays on the incumbent and she follows the optimal strategy thereafter, she's going to be on the incumbent with probability pi I and on the entrant with probability PE. So this is going to be an expected utility if she stays on the incumbent and waits for the next opportunity. And there's going to be migration if this condition is holds, and we can say much more about it, but that's the basic spirit. Let me just show you very briefly the, so this is just an example, okay? The paper goes through a more general thing, but let's go through and through two types of migration processes. The first time is word of mouth. So the probability that an entrant, that a consumer on the incumbent is asked to move is proportional to the number of agents who are on the entrant. So you learn from about the entrant from your friends. So the more people on, are on the entrant, the greater the probability you say, oh yes, somebody's telling me move to this great platform, okay? And in this case, the migration pattern is has got this kind of S shape. Very few people move at the start. I have to cheat a little bit because, oh, sorry. Here on the left axis, on the y-axis, I've got the number of people on the incumbent, okay? So assume that some people have randomly moved, because if nobody has moved, nobody's ever going to move, but assume there's been an epsilon group of people who've moved, then very few people are going to move, and then that's going to accelerate, okay? The other process we can think about is a process where a constant proportion of the agent on the incumbent platform hear about the new platform. So this is basically a standard Poisson process. In this case, the number of agents on the incumbent platform has got the shape. And you can mix the two processes. Here is what happens if I add the two processes I looked about. You've got this strange shape here. And here's the what happens if you mix them, but you assume that the Poisson process is less powerful, so that the word of mouth is more important. Okay, and what we can show, and we can generalize this, you know, to more general away from the example, is that the greater the word of mouth component is, the less likely is migration. Okay, so in some sense, migration depends on the type of the behavioral pattern by which the agents are learning about the migration opportunities and how they decide to do this. And then we can show very easily that migration is more, this is wrong, okay, sorry. This is wrong, okay, don't look at the, I'm trying to kind of, okay. Migration is more likely when consumers have only one opportunity to migrate, okay? The sentence is exactly the opposite of what I should have written, okay? So the fact of, indeed, the Farrell-Salone result is in some sense that just a knife edge. And then we play with a number of alternatives of, to the model and so on to see whether it gives kind of reasonable prediction. And for instance, one which I find important is that multi-homing makes migration more likely. So if a consumer can migrate, but at the same time, when it's migrated, can keep its membership on the old platform for a certain time, under rather general conditions about the utility of multi-homing, you find that migration is more likely than with single-homing. In our report from the commission, we said that there should be a presumption of guilt for incumbent platforms who use strategies which prevent multi-homing. You know, in some sense, this is a backing. It was based on that type of connection. Okay, so just to conclude very briefly, so that we have time for some discussions. First, you know, in the models which I've shown you, the distribution of switching costs and network effects is quite important. Okay, the striking result, even consumers to which the incumbent platform doesn't sell can influence the outcome when we've got even network effect of switching costs. Okay, and that's a result which I think we've got to kind of keep in mind. And strategic behavior, the strategic behavior of consumers when they're thinking about migrating between platforms could be an important explanation of incumbency advantage. So for instance, there's a very nice and impressive paper by Kempe-Kleinberg and Taylor in 2015, where they look at migration in a complicated network structure like the one we were discussing earlier in response to a question. And but here, there is no strategic behavior. The consumers migrate if a sufficient number of their neighbors in the graph have migrated. Okay, and I must admit, I have a real problem of knowing intellectually what we should do. Clearly, assuming those type of behavior, very mechanical behavior, I think gives wrong results. Consumers do think, okay? I don't think that consumers think strategically enough and completely strategically, so that if we've got a very complicated network structure, they're able to completely figure out what's going to happen. And I don't know. We need to find some intermediary models, a really interesting intellectual questions about how to model this. Okay, and very briefly, the research issues which you know I really would like to see. Enjoy reading more papers. I'm getting too old to write papers. I want to specialize in reading good papers now. Okay, so why and when would agents have difficulties of coordinating to a better platform? We present one explanation, but there could be other explanations for the lack of coordination. It would be interesting to have people thinking about this. Here, I haven't, the dynamic strategies of platforms have been very, very simple, just pricing, and they're really not very dynamic, but it would be very interesting to speak about innovation, how platforms differentiate between each other. Sometimes there's multi-homing, but in strange ways, which is I can communicate with Mike by telephone, by WhatsApp, and by email, depending on the circumstance. And what does this mean in terms of what are network effects? And as far as I know, we've got absolutely no, got very little data and no real theory about what happens in those cases. And I think they're very important issues. Another aspect, which is kind of, I'd like to point out, is that there's lots of work on switching costs. There's lots of work on network effects. There is very, very little work on both of them at the same time. Okay, so actually really nothing. Okay, so it's a, and there's a big survey by Farrell and Salone that lots of you, Farrell and Klemperer, that lots of you have seen about network effects and switching costs. But if you look at the survey, it's A, switching costs, B, network effects. And there is nothing in at the intersection. Okay. And of course, adding to sidedness is important. And I have to say this because otherwise, if I go back to the building at TSC, I'm going to get into trouble. Okay. And finally, the papers have been kind of basing myself up here. So this is the most self-serving selected bibliography, only papers I've written. No, actually, it's because I like Gary very much, and it's only papers that Gary has written, so it will look a little bit like last episode. Well, thank you very much, and I'd be very happy to answer questions, your comments, and in particular, if there are some of the papers, people have written papers which are relevant to all of this, which I have not seen, please send them to me. I would love to see them.